Everyone and welcome on the Sunset Safari. My name's Brent. I've got Brian and the Thumb on camera. We have Eugene and Nikki in final control, and James and Andrew on the other vehicle. Welcome here to Djuma, private game reserve in the Sabi Sands, South Africa. We are on a live safari, so everything we're seeing, you're seeing at the same time as us. We're also interactive, so you're able to ask us questions about what we're seeing out here in the African bush. You can do that by emailing to... Oh, sorry. Game drive radio making a bit of noise. You can do that by emailing questions at WildEarthTV, or you can just use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. So for those of you who might have missed the sunrise safari this morning, we were lucky enough to find Shadow's cub out near Impala Plains. I think James is going to head into that area, see if he can find it this afternoon, and we're going to try follow up on those mysterious female leopard tracks we were following. So hopefully we have some luck. It's a really nice warm afternoon here. It's 28 degrees Celsius, which is 83 degrees Fahrenheit. A lovely winter's day here in Africa, and I hope you guys enjoy, and please feel free to send as many questions as possible. We really do appreciate getting them, so let's go see what we can find. In the beginning of the drive, you might see me use the game drive radio a bit. That's just so we can all figure out where everyone's going, so we're not covering. So we're going to head into that area where we last had those female leopard tracks this morning, before we decided to head off to go have a look at that young male leopard. So, while it's a bit warm, we might find a lot of the sort of general game species are going to be resting in the shade, especially the ruminants chewing the cud. Cools down, we'll start sets. We can see the bush is drying out nicely now, and the colors on the trees are almost all yellow using their leaves. Dry season. From a tracking point of view, it makes the tracks a lot easier to see. Your visibility is much better, so you do get to see some incredible interaction at this time of the year. Not to say it's not there during the wet season, it's just a little bit harder to find. For those who are on the sunrise safari, I heard there was a little bit of confusion about that Stevens beaked blind snake. So if you are interested, on my Twitter account I did post a picture and its full name in that, so you can find it there. The Stevens beaked blind snake that we saw on the sunrise safari. area is actually named after this big tree. Quite a unique tree. The little tree to the right is also of the same species. But magnificent tree. The seeds can be used to make firewood. You can see it behind that little combretum. There's the big tree at the back with a very distinct twisted trunks. So the oil from inside the seeds of this tree can be used to make a fire torch. That's a little hint for you. And it has really big thorns. We'll get up a bit closer. It's actually one of the only trees I think I've never ever actually seen a leopard in. But you don't really want to be barefoot under these guys. You can have a look at the leaves now. So who can tell me which tree? How many can we see here? I can see 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. At least 7, possibly a few more hiding in the bushes. Now I know I spoke about short grasses being good for, so zebras are hindgut fermenters. Not today. Oh, there's some more at the back, so 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, I can see 8, could be a few more even. The one to the closest to us on the right is the stallion, much thicker neck at a quick glance. Let's get a little bit closer. See if we can get a bit closer now. There's also a herd of impala with them. If you look quite carefully, you can see where the zebras are feeding. If you look at the grass, we zoom in on the grass in the center there. You can see, compared to the other grass around, there's quite a bit more green. And that's why they are feeding this area, and that's why all the impala are feeding in this area as well. So there's water that's moving naturally under the ground there, and that's what's causing this grass to remain green a bit longer than the grass away from the seep lines. So you've got a bachelor group of impala and zebras feeding in this area. Well done, Deb, Kathleen, Meg, on getting the correct answer, and Julia about getting the correct answer for the torchwood tree that we just saw. It's called a torchwood or green thorn. That is the name of that tree. The road we were on, where it's named after, is called Balanites Road, which is the beginning of the Latin name for the Torchwood. I know a lot of the regular viewers will know I like to play a few games with you guys, specifically to do with collective nouns. So, who can tell me what the collective noun of a herd of zebra is? So, what is the original collective noun for zebra? More common, the used one is a herd, but there's an original colonial collective noun for zebra that's quite fun. So who can tell me what the collective noun for zebra is? You can send your answers to questions at WildEarthTV, or just use the hashtag Safari Live if you're on Twitter. Edge of the seep line before it goes into the drainage line. There are the two foals. So we'll leave the zebra and impala to feed on, and we're gonna go try and find those female leopard tracks again. Mobile stations, is any station copying me? A lone wildebeest bull. Also utilizing these short grass plains on the edge of the seep lines. Looks like he's making his way towards where the zebra are slowly. When we saw them this morning, they were actually together. When we shot past them to try and get to that leopard, an important reason for that is that wildebeest and zebra are very different types of grazers. A zebra is what you would call a bulk grazer. It eats most grasses indiscriminately, and most length of grass, where there's a wildebeest is a very specific type of feeder and actually needs animals like zebra and buffalo that are bulk grazers, because they are very finicky feeders and will feed in between and only picking certain species at certain lengths. Oh, lots of general game on these short plains today.
Yeah, afternoon, nothing so far.
Looks like you guys are on fire today
with your answers. Quick.
Cynthia and Susan and Robin, well done. You guys were the first with the answer to that dazzle of zebra. Dazzle of zebra. I think it's quite fitting, all those stripes. Oh, hello. Little one. Oh, he's got a itchy bum. So Stenbok, quite interesting. If you can see carefully under his eye, it's a pre-orbital gland there. There in both eyes you can see them. And those are very important for Stenbok for marking their territory, to keep other Stenbok out. They live in very, very small territories, only about 2 hectares. And they will defend them quite vigorously from other Stenbok. Because they live in such small territories, they bury their feces to try and mask their presence in an area from predators. They also are monogamous. They do mate for life, unless obviously one of the partners is killed. And another very interesting thing is they are not water dependent. They can survive without drinking from the moisture they get from what they eat and from the dew in the early morning. So I'm quite sure the female will be somewhere around here quite close. Walk so quietly, always listening. So their name is actually a derivative from an Afrikaans word, which is a baksteen or a steen, which is a brick. They're called a brick antelope. It was one of their defensive mechanisms against predators is to keep dead still. They'll sit down and keep as still as a brick, basically. So, and I've actually seen wild dogs sniff within 30 centimeters of them, and with them keeping still, the wild dogs, without them moving, the wild dogs didn't get that chase trigger, and they just completely moved on from the area, and the Stenbok was completely safe. Okay, well, leave him. It's afternoon foraging. This is a strange looking track up there. So we're still getting towards that area where we last had the female tracks, but there's been so much stuff that's slowing us down. So we're going to cross over to James, and that's going to give us a chance to get into that area, and we'll see what James has been up to, and we'll catch up with you a little bit later.
Hello everyone, welcome to our afternoon safari. You find me a little out of breath. We have Andrew behind the camera. He is dressed as a pirate today for some reason. So you can be thankful you've got me in front of camera and not him. Something over his mouth, it's a bit odd. Anyway, we've been searching for some leopard back here, and there was a small cub scene this morning, which I think you all saw, or those of you who were insomniac enough in North America saw, and those who were having your morning coffee in Britain or Switzerland or Finland or somewhere like that, I'm sure you saw him. It was Shadow's cub, and we looked in the area where he was this morning. We can't find him there. And I'm just going to get Andrew to pan onto some tracks here. I'll try and point them out to you. So he was over there, down in the depression down there, and he seems to have come up and around, and his tracks have come out of the block and onto the road here where you can see them. Now, I'm not sure, can you see my hand?
Yes, Andrew? Perfectly.
So you can see here is his track. His four little front pads and his back pad. And he looks like he's come out of the block just behind the vehicle, walked along here. He's come along here like this. And that's where we've kind of lost him. Looks like he may have headed off in there, and so we're going to follow up through there and see if we can't find him. We have done a loop of the area. I just spiked myself on a thorn. This is deeply painful. I'm struggling not to cry. Anyway, we're going to go through here and see if we can't pick him up. Doesn't look like he's come out of the block at all, although there has been quite a lot of traffic on this road here, so I may have missed a track or two. If I did, it's probably Andrew's fault. If you'd like to tell me anything about him, remember the Twitter handle, hashtag Safari Live. If you want to ask me anything about him, you can do it on that way too. Or send us an email. Just going to knock Andrew's head off here. Send us an email at questions.wildearth.tv. Now, I believe this leopard is about 8 months old, and so it's quite unusual that he's not with his mum. She's probably out hunting. And it's unlikely, if she hasn't come back to fetch him, it's unlikely he'd have gone far from here. But it's also very likely that he's lying quite low. I initially expected him maybe to be in some tall tree, and that's often what young leopards will do if they're waiting for their mothers. But there's nothing really appropriate in this area. There are a couple of knob thorns, and lying in a knob thorn just sounds very uncomfortable. So what we're looking for is probably in the deep shade, lying low in some thick grass. What we don't want to do is freak him out. While he is so the track very big fella yet, so you'll see human eyes. Something like this sort of shade off to my right here is where I would expect to find him, but you never can tell. Textbooks will always tell you one thing, and just when you think you've got a handle on it all, the animal will do something completely different. Termite mound over there, which I'm just going to go past, and then we'll probably go back out onto the road and see and sort of do a wider loop if you like. And that'll be cover a bit more ground. Fortunately, it's nearly my right eye. Nearly my left. There's an encroacher species that we just flattened called Acacia exuvialis, or the flaky thorn. Plenty more where that one came from, so fear not. The termite mound off to the right here that I was looking at. Maybe in the shade of that gwarry bush. Okay, nothing here. So we're going to go back out onto the road. Slightly wider loop, and then see if we can't pick him up, pick his tracks up there. In the meantime, we'll get your intellectual juices flowing. I know you know what those are, so you can tell me what they are first, and then you can tell me what they're used for. Couple of obvious ones. Beautiful four-winged fruit. Dispersed by the wind. Many hundreds of which, sorry, Andrew is signaling to me wildly to tell me that my ear you've been, never mind, we'll forgive you this time. We're searching through the grass here for a leopard cub who is about 8 months old. I've never seen him, so I'm quite those of you who were here in the morning, he was found around this area. Apparently he is Shadow's cub. I've never seen either of them. Trying to look for is just to see sort of appropriate places for a small cub to lie, like in the deep shade or in a tree. I'm gonna have a look there with my binoculars. I've spotted a stick. Fascinating. Not a leopard. Sorry about that, a stick. Come back to another, approach this area from a different angle. Question from Susan in the Netherlands. Susan, you'd like to know, welcome to this search for the elusive spotted cat. You'd like to know if a cub of this one's age, which is about 8 months, would survive if its mother died. The answer is, in this environment, it would be highly unlikely. I'm just going to get Andrew underneath this branch here and stall the car at the same time. And so, Susan, I don't think he would survive. Just simply because there are too many other predators in the area, and he's not able, he won't be anywhere near able to defend a territory at this stage of his life. Came out here originally, seems to have gone back in, but he may have found a Franklin to chase or a scrub hare and ended up miles from, oh, we got more tracks here. There he goes. You see him, Andrew?
A bit too close for me.
Too close, sorry. So he's come, seems to have turned on and come up the road here and gone in over here. Well, let's follow the tracks and see where they lead. At the end of them, there must be a leopard, presumably. Unless he's learned to fly. So, Susan, I hope that answers your question. Normally, a leopard will need to be probably about 18 months old before they'll be able to survive on their own. Maybe a year old. Looking in the top of the marula trees, they've got the smoothest bark, so that'd be the most comfortable place for a delicate leopardine belly to lie. It's interesting that a lot of people think of leopards as being arboreal species or species that live in trees. And in places where competition is absent, so there are no hyenas or lions or wild dog in the area, leopard are seldom found in trees. And so they'll also seldom stash their kills in trees unless there is competition from other predators like hyenas or wild dogs, especially lions. answers to the question on the seed pods, which we're going under again, different tree. These are, the major answer seemed to have some sort of something to do with bush willows or Combretaceae, Combretums, and that's what they are. Well done, everyone. Somebody got it exactly correct. They are, in fact, the russet bush willow. Marlene, you're a tree genius. The russet bush willow, Combretum herreroense. Named for a Namibian tribe, the Hereros. Why? I have absolutely no idea. I'm just going to try and look at the road here and see if he did come out of the block. There seems to be a tree on a termite mound, hoping there'd be a little leopard lying in it, but alas, there is. So we'll do another loop, we'll keep trying, we shall fearlessly forge ahead. Celia on Twitter, welcome to the afternoon game drive, or afternoon bush bashing as it is at the moment. You've said, does the russet bush willow smell like potatoes? The answer is no, it doesn't smell like potatoes. It actually has a sort of very nondescript smell. You can use the pods to make a tea. I've done that. It tastes about the same as it smells, like nothing. But it will, the pods do sort of taint the tea with color, so it looks like tea. The bush that smells like a potato is something called Phyllanthus reticulatus, or the potato bush. And that's a very distinctive tree, grows in drainage lines and smells mainly only at night, because I think it's pollinated by a nocturnal moth, and so it only needs to attract things at nighttime. So only when the temperature drops, especially around this time of year, does it smell. For me, it's a tremendous tremendous smell of nostalgia, because it's one of the first smells I learnt in the bush. on Twitter, welcome. Nice to have you with us. Thanks for your question. You'd like to know if the cub is... and have a listen. Often what happens is we bash around in the bush like this and we don't hear anything. And the birds, especially things like will alarm call when they see a leopard, as will the sticklers or the helmet shrikes or the battises. And so if we drive around, we bash the trees over and we have this noisy engine revving, we often don't hear the birds.
Any updates as well?
Of course, there's nothing but stony silence from all birds at the moment. All we can hear is the gentle rustling of the wind. Suppose the wind through a camera doesn't sound quite the same as it does in reality. Well, it's quite pleasant for us. It's probably a bit of a grating noise for you. Right, nothing going on here. We're going to do a slightly wider loop this time and see what we come up with. I've been tremendously frustrated by the leopards on this reserve since my arrival. They have conspired to make me look foolish. I think Brent also had some other male leopard tracks earlier, so maybe he'll come up with them. Another game drive ahead of us. They're driving rather too fast to be following a leopard, unfortunately. Found only forests of Combretum.
Oh, good.
Yes.
No
leopard. No leopard. Did you see him this morning? And was he? He was in stationary in the drainage line. Was he?
Close to the drainage line.
Okay, moving this way. There was a couple of tracks coming in into the block here. So I don't know. We've driven the place pretty flat. And I don't think he's crossed out.
This side.
And he certainly hasn't crossed out that side, yeah.
Didn't check any tracks this side.
No, he came out and then he went back in again. Yeah. So, I mean, are you going to hang around and look?
Yeah, definitely.
Okay. I'm going to go a little bit further down and then cut across again and see what I can see.
Here and drive a parallel road over here.
Okay.
See
cool. I've got no comms, so.
Me either.
Okay. I'll rev loudly if I find it. Or whoop like a hyena. Ooh. Nice to have a few people helping us. A proverbial needle in a haystack stuff. They do say perseverance pays, though. Whoever they are. It's possible that his mother break this up a little bit. I'm going to try and show you something little and interesting. Now, let's have a look here. Sorry, Andy. You can see there that this thorn has been stung by something called a slender ant. Now what they do, that's a stung thorn. And this one is not. So you can see how the stung one is swollen. A bit like your skin might swell if you were stung by an insect. And I'm just going to open this up and see if the ant isn't still inside. And no, he's not. He's gone already. As you can see, that's where his home is. That's where the larva lives. The larva goes in there and eats out the nutritious sort of pith in the side of the, in the middle of the thorn, and then goes on his way and bites another thorn and lays his eggs. Or her eggs, sorry. Males don't normally lay eggs. Okay, let us continue after that small cameo in the quest for the spotted cat. There was just a tweet question about whether I'm the only one out this afternoon. The answer is no. Brent is also about, but my illustrious partner seems to have trouble with his communications. So something's wrong with his signal, and that's why you're not seeing him at the moment. So I'm afraid you're stuck with me for the next little while. Thank you. the Scotia tree we came to earlier. Tracks on the road. Close. That's called a red thorn, and that's why it's called. One of many acacias we get out here. And we've got knobthorn acacias, acacia exuvialis, we've got acacia nigrescens, we have acacia nilotica, we have acacia burkeii, we have acacia erubescens maybe. I haven't seen them here, but they should be here. So with all that Latin, we will proceed with our effort. This area is a bit clearer than some of the others, freer of trees, because the soil is quite sodic or sodium rich. And you can see that, I don't know if you can see it in your camera, you might be able to. The soil is quite white, it's quite pale. So it's almost toxic to some plant species, but some of the animals love it. Andrew, just see if you can get that bird there. Turn and blow. See if any of you can identify him. Oh, that's beautiful the way he's coming to hover just above us. Glorious bird with very ignoble intentions. Any ideas? Send me the answer. Carolina, you'd like to know, at what age does a leopard make the sawing sound? Gene, I don't think you're the Gene that I know from North Carolina, otherwise you'd definitely have addressed me with a smart comment. But Gene from North Carolina, a leopard can make a sawing sound. It's a very good question. I would think almost from puberty. So they're definitely, you can, with lions, I know that their larynx is not born calcified. So when they're born, they make that very kind of soft mewling meow, meow, meow sound. That's a pretty horrific impression, but something like that. And then as the larynx ossifies or gets bony, they so that the sound will get much deeper and they make a sort of typical big cat sound. Now with a leopard, it's probably very similar. I suspect around about 18 months, the larynx will start to ossify, and so the sound will get deeper, and then they'll start to make that throaty kind of growl. This vehicle's going to give up on me. It's going to tell me it's had enough of the abuse. Nothing there, Andrew, don't worry. On Twitter, the resident bird genius for the day, you had correctly identified that bird as an African harrier hawk, or gymnogene, the old name, and that is indeed what it was. I said with nefarious intentions, because they normally pluck sort of nestlings from the nest, so the leopard on the road here. I'm just going up the side of the road there, Andrew. Look how fresh those are. Tracks will be very difficult to age on a road like this, because there have been lots of cars coming up and down, and so that'll create a wind which will in turn blow sand into the tracks, which would normally be quite a good way of aging them, but very difficult in this situation. On the road here. off and have another listen. Again, just silence. We'll head up this drainage line and see what we find in the end there. And then we might give up and go and see what else we can see. Unless there's a sufficient support for me to carry on just looking for it. Which I'm happy to do. If that's what you'd like to do. I believe Brent is back online, which is nice. I'm going to let you cross over to him and see what he's got. We're going to keep looking for the leopard, and hopefully when you come back to us, we'll have his golden spots in the setting sun. Okay, see you just now.
Welcome back, everyone. Sorry, we've been gone for so long. We had a minor radio difficulty, so we had to go get that fixed quickly. All working now, so off we go again. We did get back onto those female leopard tracks. She actually came all the way down to the edge of quarantine clearing. We're right on the sort of southern edge of quarantine at the moment. And we're just having a careful look around here. I mean, these tracks are quite old. Hopefully she's laying up in this drainage line somewhere and she's going to come out now. It's getting a bit cooler. Other than that, we probably, if we don't get any luck in this area, we're going to go check through around the dams, maybe head up towards Buffalo. Time of the day when animals, predators start moving, so always a good time to be out. That she's gone into these thickets down to the south of us. Let's check very carefully around here. And some hyena tracks. Tracks here. where the elephants are. I'm sitting there.
Can I get it up?
The elephants do move quite often, and they can move big distance, so it's possible that they're just not around at the moment, but they should be back, I'm sure, within a day or so. So as I said, didn't get any luck through there. So we're gonna check the water. It is getting dry, so water is always a good point to look. So we're gonna go check the little water hole in front of Gallagher Camp, then down to Vuyatela Dam, and then onwards and northwards and eastwards towards Buffalo's Hook. Saying earlier, this is the beginning of my favorite time of the year. I probably have to say my favorite time of the year is sort of the end of October, beginning of November. It is incredibly dry, but it's also incredibly warm, and there's very little water around, there's very little grass, so the animals are pushed onto the remaining water points. Your visibility is amazing. A lot of the trees don't have leaves, the grass is very short. So it's a really, really good time to see things. And also from a tracking point of view, tracking of the predators is much easier at that time of the year. Approaching this little water hole, we'll be arriving there quite shortly. I'm going to take a gander that there's more than likely some old buffalo bulls there. They haven't started moving yet, it's not quite cool enough, but as it gets cooler they are going to move away from these low-lying areas around the water and move towards the crests. Because warm air rises, so these low-lying areas get very cold. Imagine if you're an old buffalo bull, you want to be a bit higher, a little bit of warmth, a bit more comfort during the night. Well, I might have been wrong. Not a buffalo bull in sight. Oh, look at that stunning color. Just sparkling. Now, there's a very important reason why a lot of birds have that iridescence on their feathers. And it's to do with most things, like most things in nature, most of the adaptations are to do with either finding food or finding a mate. So a starling that loses color and can look quite dull is generally a sign with the starlings that they're in bad condition. So here we go, walk into the sunlight for us. So it shows that they're in bad condition, but if they're really bright and shiny and that iridescence is sort of vibrant and almost glowing, it shows that the bird is in very good condition, and the females will always try to pick the shiniest male. And that's not only in starlings, certain kingfisher species as well also have that. But it is really, really visible in Starling. And a very bright yellow eye. They're busy foraging around for insects, grubs, larvae. This is a Cape glossy starling. It's always good to stop and look at the little things. It gives you a chance to listen and to see if the bush is letting us know if there's anything else about. You might hear a branch break, let you know that there's some elephants about. You might hear alarm calls, let you know there's a predator about. Tracks carefully. Favorite haunt of Inyala around the edges of these drainage lines. Being browsers, there's a lot more tree species around the edge of dry water courses, so it gives them a lot more options when it comes to browsing. They are very beautiful antelope. And see the tails. We can just catch that white under flash of the tail when they swing it to keep the flies away. But that flash is very important when they're trying to evade predators or warning other things. So they'll bark and they'll run and they'll lift that tail, and all the other Inyala that are around will be able to see that there's a predator around or there's something dangerous around when they lift that tail. And that very, very clean, bright white shines through. So it got there, picked up something small and then dropped it. It's looking for whatever it dropped. It looked like maybe a small piece of bone. Quite a few different animal species will pick up small bits of bone and chew on them. Can anyone out there tell me what that's called? There we go, picking up the bone again. It's got a piece of bone. It dropped it again. There we go. So they do that for calcium, but there's a very specific term for that. So can anyone out there tell me what that term is? You can send your answers to questions at wildearth.tv on email, or you can use the hashtag Safari Live on Twitter. Oh, another one. Hop and a skip and a jump through the bush. Let's just move a little bit forward. And you can actually have a look at the bone pieces that were being picked up there. Very difficult type of, but it's quite common practice. A lot of the mammal species will do it. Giraffe do it often. I've seen impala and nyala and wildebeest doing it before. Oh, they're about to disappear in the thicket. We're gonna continue on, see what else is out there this afternoon. Just remember the question: what is the specific term for when a herbivore or a non-carnivore species picks up pieces of bone to chew and chews them for calcium? Lovely late afternoon light coming through now. Check the termite mounds. Leopards love to sit on termite mounds. Oh, he's sneaky quick, that. Might catch him. We inch forward. No, he's off. It was a black-crowned chagra that just zooted in front of us. Teresa's asking us about termite mounds, and luckily enough we have one right next to us. Teresa would like to know if there is one particular termite mound that is the largest and oldest that we know about, and she also she said she's always noticed there's mounds under trees, and is there specific trees where termites would choose to form their mounds. Well, Teresa, I haven't noticed a particularly big one. There are some very, very big ones here that are still active, but I haven't noticed one that's sort of hugely bigger and older than the others. I mean, a termite mound is a bit like an iceberg. So you're only seeing about a third of it, that two-thirds under the ground. But now, to do with the trees, this is a nice, really nice one to explain this to you. If you have a look at those little bushes growing out of the side of the termite mound, it's not so much the termite mound, the termites that choose the trees, but it's the trees that choose the termite. And what happens is, those there are called grivias, those are little raisin bushes. So you will find that a bird is fed off those bushes, and then they've come to sit on this termite mound. It's a nice vantage point, and then they've defecated on the termite mound. If you are higher up there, you can even see there's a little bit of bird dropping on the termite mound where a bird has been sitting on it. So, and that puts the seeds, and the termites are obviously bringing soil up from down, so there's quite a lot of nutrients on a termite mound. And then what happens, it's called succession, basically. We'll start off with a few small raisin bushes like that. Then you might find that there's a jackalberry seed deposited there by a bird. Now that there's a bit of a bush to sit in. And or a boer bean seed, and then or a timbuti seed. Then slowly but surely, the trees will actually colonize the mound, utilizing the fact that it's bringing up nutrients and that the birds have deposited them there. So that's why you often find trees on top of termite mounds, and it's generally a couple of different species that are favored by birds to eat. So Teresa, I hope that helps you there with your termite mound question. Nothing around the Gallagher waterhole, or we'll tell a dam. So we're gonna head north and east towards Buffalzok. See if there's anything there. Then we're gonna keep on the dam theme today. We'll go north and east to Buffalzok. If we get nothing around Buffalzok, we'll then go south and west towards Treehouse and Twin Dams and Treehouse. Did have tracks of a male leopard, looked like a young male leopard, crossing out at Treehouse Dam. I'm just going to go through a little dip here where the signal might get a bit bad, and then I'll start talking again on the other side.